So from Brian Adams to welcome. Paul
hello.
And Jacqui,
hi,
hello.
You okay?
Very well. And I'll give you a formal introduction in a moment. Brian Adams fans?
Yeah, I'm a fan of him as a person. I saw him on here the other week and I thought he seems lovely. He doesn't quite have the same effect as
I was going to say, did you
Carol,
feel dizzy and swooning
no,
after
No, not quite
making...
that way, but yeah, I like him.
Let's give you a formal introduction. They once performed together as part of the one most successful British bands of the 90s, The Beautiful South. Then Paul Heaton and Jacqui Abbot lost touch.
Well, after more than a decade apart, they were reunited through social media, got back into the recording studio and have now released their second album together.
Let's take a look at some of their work over the years.
Watching telly, think of me instead. I'll never grow so old and flabby. That could never be. Don't marry her, have me. This could be Rotterdam or anywhere. Liverpool or Rome. Cause Rotterdam is anywhere, anywhere alone. Anywhere alone. She was so determined to take it right out of my head. If you're all in love, it's to you on my river's dance. Why? Well, she was young and pretty, and young and pretty's better than I. But we gave them all our kisses, now they found another missus, because they lost me to a DIY.
Get all those words out so quickly.
I'm looking at it now.
Two takes on that. That was a live performance outside Broadcasting House.
It was live and a bit nervous. We tend to go fast when we get nervous.
Yeah, speed up.
You still get nervous then?
On telly, yeah. I get nervous on telly, but not so much playing concerts. It's quite easy.
After the last album you sang, you did together, you actually this time managed to keep each other's phone numbers.
Yes, we did, yeah. We kept in touch.
Which was handy.
Yeah, there wasn't really much of a gap between this one and the last one. And inspired by working with Jacqui, I managed to write a lot of new songs for this one, sort of while we were working on the last one. It was almost going straight from the end of the tour for What Have We Become to recording this new one.
What is it about Jacqui that makes you want to write her to sing?
Initially, I suppose it was her voice. And her voice, she's got remarkably similar diction to mine. And she can get the words out, like you heard on DIY, really clearly. She's got the same sort of similar voice to how mine is, so that makes it easy writing for her. But also, just having a female sort of person in the band, it's like having two lots of ways to write every song. So rather than it being limited, it actually throws you open as a writer.
So how does it work, Jacqui? Paul writes, and then are you involved in any of that writing process,
no.
Or do you just you get it and then you say yes?
They go away. You know, he goes away for a little bit and goes away again with Johnny, the guitarist, and. Even years ago, it was the same thing with Dave Rotherham. I think he knows roughly in his mind the male and female kind of split between the lyrics kind of thing, because that's kind of the premise of the song, you know, like the back and forth between male and female. But when it comes back and kind of there's a skeletal version of all the songs, it's then like you kind of hope as well a little bit. If you've heard the versions in rough form, you kind of do think, I like that bit.
Yeah.
I hope that I get that bit.
Well, let's see how it works out then. Here's the first single from the new album. It's called The Austerity of Love.
Sugar is the centre of the honeycomb.
Austerity, there's a word you wouldn't expect to find in a pop song a few years ago, certainly, but not a great surprise. Now, I mean, there's a political element to your music, quite a strong one. Yeah. I was very struck by one song on the album about a place called Heatongrad. Now, we can't quote the song because there is strong language from the very beginning, as you know, because you wrote it. Yeah. What sort of a place is Heatongrad?
Possibly, it's a tongue-in-cheek place. It's a place that doesn't actually exist. But I see it as a line from sort of Liverpool to Hull, really, where everybody's under my thrall, really. And it's a bit tongue-in-cheek, and it's a sort of a place owned by me and dictated to by me.
Yeah, I was going to say, is it your version of Imagine?
Yes. For people who haven't heard the lyrics, that's a very funny thing to say. But yes,
Has your, Bill mentioned there's a political element or some thinking to your writing. Has that, do you think that's become more prevalent as the years have gone by?
Yeah, I think it used to be that I've always had a sort of angry political side, but it used to be that it would take a while to think of it. And nowadays, I'm sure a lot of people agree, it only takes me like 100 yards out of the house and I get angry about something. And you become more... it's easier to express yourself, I think, when you're older. I think when I was younger, I look back at some of the stuff with the House Martins and it sort of seems a bit party political, while something more recent, like Heatongrad, is a bit more fun, even though it's the strong language. Yeah. I think you just learn a bit more about yourself as you get older.
Do you ever, when he first presents you with a song, do you ever look at lyrics and go, oh, come on. Really?
No.
You're always in agreement.
No,
I
always think that he's wrote it for a reason and it's usually a good reason behind it, do you know what I mean?
Now, some bands, they start off recording in the Shires, if you like, then they go to London, then they think, let's go to Paris or the south of France or L.A. But you went a really long way. You went to Castleford in Yorkshire to record this.
Yes, we really pushed the boat.
Never tempted to go further afield. I mean, because some people say, we get influenced by our surroundings.
Yeah, I know. It does sound like a weird place to go, but first of all, it's a great place. Secondly, it's a place that's near to our homes, sort of actually geographically, and we've both got fairly young families, so we were able to go back if we wanted and stay if we didn't want to see our family. it was a great place, and it's a brilliant studio then and lovely people. I think LA, I don't know if we'd suit LA for some reason.
I might push for it in the future.
Can't imagine either of us with a suntan, really.
Nashville, though.
Nashville would be great.
Very pale.
Plans to tour?
Yeah, we're going on tour on Wednesday, aren't we?
Wednesday's the first day. And then we do, which is about nine, I don't know how many days.
Yeah, it's about nine dates.
Nine dates.
You think the sound on this album is more raw than previously, really?
I think, there's a little bit more variation. I do tend to sort of write pop songs, and I think because we were a bit confident after the last one, we managed to sort of say the single is a little bit reggae-influenced, and there's a bit more influences. Raw might have been an exaggeration in hindsight.
Yes, you're not mellowing but you are mellowing in old age. When I say old age, as you...
Bill, take it
back. That's OK, I don't mind that.
Don't worry, I'm the oldest person on the sofa by some margin.
No, I don't mind being called old age. No, I'm not really mellowing as such. I haven't noticed it yet. I don't think anybody else has noticed it.
The ever-youthful Paul and Jacqui, thank you very much
for
joining us.
Thank you.
Paul and Jackie's album is called Wisdom, Laughter and Lines.